Hey there, I'm Sean C. Davis, and this is the fourth and final video in a series of videos where we've gone from an opinionated call-out-based block system in Notion, and we then set up our integration and our connection to a database, and then we exported all that content to a JSON file, and now in this video, we're going to take that raw export, and we're going to transform it into a nice, tidy JSON object that can be used with any framework for any website, and you can feed it into pages and components and build these incredibly complex, visually rich components where they are all sourced from Notion. The goal is really just to build a foundation around this idea that you can then take and apply to your own system and your own websites. Now, if you haven't watched the previous videos, but you have worked with the Notion API, you may be able to get by. All we've really done is we've exported the Notion API data into a big JSON blob, and we've taken all blocks and block children and applied them to properties called children on each page and each block within that page. So if you can do that and replicate that, you don't need any of the videos before. You should be able to follow along just fine. But with that, let's dive in and write some code. All right, like before, I just have a blank Node.js project. The only thing unique in here is I have pulled over my Notion export.json file. This is that JSON export that we built in part 3. Let's get our dependencies installed. And all we're gonna use right now is going to be highlight.js. And we're going to use this to transform code blocks that our front end can consume. And I'll talk a little bit more about that. Now let's write some code. And we're going to start simply with just making sure that our export file exists. So I am bringing in highlight.js because we're going to use that a little bit later. But I have defined my output file as Notion export in this particular directory. And if we don't have it, then we're going to throw an error. Otherwise, we're going to load these pages. We can make sure that this exists by logging the pages and then running the script, and we'll see what happens. And we have exactly what we'd expect. We have loaded and read this JSON file and converted them into JavaScript objects. Now let's get started with the transformation. And I'm going to paste a bit of code in here again, and then we'll talk about it. I have made a commit so that we can see what is different. And right now we'll see it's just everything here from line 14 down to line 39. So let's jump down here to line 27. And basically what we're doing is we're taking the pages object that we built. So this is the exported Notion content. And we're looping through each page in there. So we'll see right now I only have two, which you can get a quick preview if you see the previous video. And with each of these pages, we are then pulling out the properties, children and ID. We are defining, or we're passing through the ID, the title, and then we're defining the URL path from the slug property. And then to this blocks property, we're applying the result of this transform block function, and we're passing into that the children. And as I mentioned in the intro, the children is going to be all of the blocks that are attached to that particular page. And then this transform blocks theoretically could be called recursively. We'll have one case where we're going to worry about nesting, but otherwise we'll keep it super simple. So after we do that, we then have our transformed output, and we're going to write it in this directory to a file called content.json, and then we will give some feedback on the console. Okay, so let's take a look at transform blocks. If we come up here, basically what we're doing is we're looping through the blocks again, and then we are returning, if we can find a property in this object called block map, we are going to then expect that to be a function, and we're gonna call that function and pass the block into it. And if we don't have that property, then we're gonna log not supported and show the type. And then anything that was returned as null or undefined is going to get removed, and we will only have an array of the objects that still exist. Now block map is up here on 14, and right now it's just a placeholder because I wanna build this slowly with you. Okay, so if that file is saved, we basically just have this placeholder content right here. I can say, I can run the script again, and all I get is a bunch of not supported tags here, but I do have my content.json file. So I did finish the process, and we can see we have the beginning of a transformed object. So we're starting off nice and simple, but we can see this is really clean. This contains only properties that seem like they would be useful in a front-end application. Okay, now let's add our first transformer to this block map. And we're going to start with the simplest example, which are the paragraph blocks that we saw in the previous video. Okay, here is this property. So notice that this is a function that accepts this block. And if there's nothing in this paragraph, because that can happen, the default block in Notion is a paragraph block, and so it can be empty. And if it's empty, we're just going to return null, which then gets removed because of line 34 down here. Otherwise, we're going to build this object, and the object is going to have a component property called paragraph, and then it's going to have a text property, which is basically just going to loop through all of the rich text objects within that structured block and return the plain text. So what that means is if there was any bold, italic, underlined, inline code, or even emojis, that we're not going to see those. We're just going to see basic plain text, because we're showing, again, just a foundation. To really take this into something that you're going to use in production, you're really going to have to dig in and figure out exactly what you want to be able to support. But for now, we're going to keep it simple with plain text. So let's run that again. And now we see we have a lot fewer errors here. We say we're only not supporting callout, and we captured everything else. And if we go back to our content output, we have a lot more content. But again, it's easy to read, it's clean. So blocks is an array of objects. The objects have a component property that all right now say paragraph, and then each of the paragraphs have a text property. And you can see it's just plain text, no HTML, nothing like that. Okay, so paragraph was our first block type. The other block type that we saw was the callout block type. The whole system is really based on the ability to flex with callouts. This is not where the complexity is going to happen. All we're really doing here in this callout resolver is we're calling this other function that's resolve callout component and then passing the block to it. We're really diving deep down the chain here, and then resolving the callout component is where we're going to distinguish in this particular example between tabs and a code block. To do that, we need a bit more code. So let's paste some above the block map, and we're going to have an empty callout map object. So it's the same sort of idea. It's just another level lower so we can have some more opinion in a new system that's not just based on Notion block types, but is based around the icons that we grab from the callouts in Notion. And so basically what we're doing here, it's a couple things to be super opinionated and to kind of streamline this so we don't get too complex in this short time. So what we're saying here is we're only going to support external icons. These are the icons that Notion has added. So it's not emojis and it's not individual URLs that you can bring in. And then what we're doing is we're grabbing this URL for the individual icon, which is going to be an SVG file. And we're doing some magic to find the right name for that. And then that is going to be the property we would expect in the callout map. And if we don't find it, we're going to say, we aren't supporting this icon at this particular time. But otherwise, the process is really similar to the block map here, where we find the right property, and then we expect it to be a function, and we pass the block further down the chain, returning the result. And so if we do that, we're not going to see a ton happen here. We're just going to see external icon not supported. So we have a different error message, but we still have that error message, and we don't have any new content here. We still just have our paragraphs in our transform data. So we need to add a little bit more code. Let's add our resolver for our tabs callout. So what we expect here is a component property so that we also can match and have this system here with paragraphs. We have a component property. So we also want a tabs component property here. And then we'll have a tabs property, which is going to call this other function to resolve the tabs. And we're going to pass the children, which will be the tab components, which are also callout components in Notion. This is definitely the more complex example. And so to be able to support this, we need to add this resolve tabs function. So let's do that. So this expects an array of tab blocks. It loops through those. And if it doesn't find a callout, so if you put some other child into a tabs callout, it's going to say, nope, I'm going to ignore it. You know, you might want to log an error here or something like that. And then for the tabs objects, we have two properties. One is the label, which is going to be the main content from that tab. And the second is going to be the text, which is the child element in that particular tab. And so we're not getting super complex here. We just expect a label and then a paragraph below it, and that's it. And let me pull up Notion for just a minute so I can show you what I mean. Okay, here's a page that has the tab component on it. This is the tabs icon that we have targeted. And then these are individual callout components that are children of this main tab component. And in each of these callouts here, it's this main content that is going to be the tab label. And then this is a paragraph that is actually a child block of the callout. And that's where the tab content is going to be. So if we add any more blocks here, we're really just ignoring them. We're just going to grab our first block, render it, keep it super simple right now. Okay, so let's run that again. And notice we only have one error coming back about the code callout not working, but the tab one seems like it works. So let's see what we have in our export. Scroll down, and we do. We have an object, it's a component, tabs, and then it has a tabs property, which is an array of individual tab objects. So you can see how, again, nice and clean, you can take this and you can apply it to your code, and you could really easily just target these properties and then make that component interactive. And then last, let's add support for our code block. Now here is where we're going to bring in Highlight.js. And the benefit of doing this is that we're already doing all of this transformation. We got raw output from the Notion API. We're writing all this logic to transform content. It's a great opportunity to do things like add syntax highlighting, and then just let the front end worry about bringing the CSS code rather than having to further process any content. So we're already processing content. Let's just do all of the work right here. And the code you have on the front end is so much simpler. Okay, let's add this code call out. All right, this one isn't calling a separate function, so there's a little bit more going on in here. And let's take a look. It's saying if the first child is not code component, it's not a code block, then we're going to log that there's an issue and we're not going to return anything. Otherwise, we're expecting that this first child is a code block and we're going to just grab the plain text from that code and then we're going to target the language. Now, the names of the languages in Notion might differ from the library that you're using to add your syntax highlighting. In this particular case, I'm using a JavaScript example, and I know there's a one-to-one mapping, so I didn't worry about building the map just to kind of keep this code simple. And then we are processing this code. We're adding the syntax highlighting, passing the language to it, and we're returning a rich object. And again, we have the component property. Now this time we have a file name property, which is going to be the first piece of text in that callout. And then there's code, which is the highlighted in process code, and the language, which is going to be the name of that language. So if I go back to Notion again, this is the code block component. Notice I've got the code icon. This text within the callout is going to be the file name. And then notice I have a child within this callout, which is a code block set to the JavaScript language. And then there's some code here, which really it's syntax highlighted in Notion, but it just comes through the API as a plain string. Okay, now time to run this code again. We'll go to content and we'll scroll to the bottom here and we have our code block. Code block component, file name, code, language, and we're all set. Okay, so this is obviously just a very simple example and you can already see that it starts to get really complex. And that's why I wanted to share this with you because I feel like the idea itself is really powerful. You can see how we're just at the very beginning of stages that you can have this absolutely massive callout system that maps to really rich objects in your code. But to do that, you have to really dig into the structure of the content that comes out of the Notion API, transform it into what your front-end code is going to expect. And so I started with a few different examples, which are really kind of typical components that you might use in a website. I hope you can take this and build some really great things using Notion as your content source. And I'd love to hear more about how you've used it, or if you want me to dig into any more details here in future videos in this series. Leave your comments below, and I'll see you next time.